Dear students, after the last two lectures on global clustering, I want today discuss a topic that's also related to clustering, but it deals with clustering in subspaces. That is a topic that is particularly relevant if we have high dimensional data, where high means more than 3, 5, 10, because then we have data sets that are so large that global clustering typically will not yield meaningful results. What you see here in this initial image is a three-dimensional scatter plot, and you can also recognize a bit the projections to two-dimensional subspaces, so the AB subspace and the BAC subspace and the BC subspace. And you see that there are four different colors indicating four clusters, and these are subspace clusters, namely clusters that occur in two-dimensional subsets of this three-dimensional set. Yeah, so that is what we want to think about. How can we find subspaces where clustering is meaningful, and how to cluster within these subspaces? And primarily, that is a visual analytics course, we discuss how to visualize the results of this subspace clustering, yeah, which involves to convey to the user different subspaces, different subspace clusters that overlap in the elements. Yeah, so an element may, of course, belong to different subspace clusters. And there are also overlaps in the dimensions that contribute to these subspace clusters. So there's a lot of information that needs to be conveyed to the user, who as a consequence may change the algorithm, change parameters of the algorithm, define hypotheses based on the subgroups that are identified by this subspace cluster. So I want to start with strategies for subspace search and clustering. This already indicates that there are two problems, coupled problems, that can be solved either in an integrated manner or decoupled. So some algorithms just determine subspaces where clustering is meaningful, and then any clustering algorithm may be applied to these subspaces. That is one possibility. The other is that subspace search and the actual clustering is integrated within one algorithm. Yeah, so a pre-processing is typically useful, like for many other data mining methods. We have to deal with missing data, perhaps impute, that means estimate missing data, or remove data sets that are not complete would be another strategy. It may be necessary to normalize the data or to transform it to a logarithmic scale, for example. Yeah, and then we have different techniques how to visualize the results of subspace clustering. We have seen in this initial image parallel scatter plots. Parallel coordinates are also useful and better suited if we have not only two or three dimensions with respect to our subspace clusters, but let's say 5 to 10s. Graphs could be useful to show how similar subspaces are. Multiple linked views that show different information related to the subspace clustering could be useful. These are the visualization techniques that we will look at for the clustering results. And of course, as always, I try to present and discuss also applications where subspace clustering has been really used, successfully used, and led to new insight and knowledge about the data. And when talking about applications, then of course evaluation is also an essential point. Evaluation means that it is really assessed how useful a certain technique is in this application. It is one thing to apply certain data mining and visualization techniques to a particular set of data from an application field. It is another set to find out whether this leads to new hypotheses or other types of knowledge, ideally in an effective manner. Yeah, actually most problems where clustering is meaningful is actually a subspace clustering problem. So in sociology, there are many demographic data sets where a lot of information is collected, typically via questionnaires and interviews about persons. And then the question is, are there groups of persons that are similar to each other? And of course there are. But they are not similar to each other in all dimensions, if we really have asked a lot of questions and thus have a lot of dimensions. So two persons may be similar with respect to their health, and health alone is a complex concept that involves many variables. They may be similar with respect to their political attitudes, or they may be similar with respect to their mobility needs and their mobility preferences. Yeah? But it is very unlikely that two persons are similar with respect to all their health-related information, about all their political attitudes, about all their mobility needs, or wealth-related attributes. It's much more meaningful to search for different dimensions where certain persons are similar. Recommender systems are frequently used in advertising, yeah? And they are based on on concepts and knowledge related about similar interests of different people. Meaning that when I know something about a particular person based on the knowledge that I already have, there is a high likelihood that these persons are also interested in products of this or that kind. Yeah? That may be true for certain types of products, books, for example. Yeah, but to assume that people that share interest in the same books also share interest in the same sports or in the same music is typically not correct. Yeah? Another area in science is gene expression data that is used in biology and bioinformatics. So the DNA is analyzed with microarray chips, and genes are grouped with clustering according to their so-called expression profiles. Yeah? That means that under certain circumstances, genes express certain proteins. And some genes are similar to each other with respect to certain environmental conditions. Yeah? So they express the same proteins even under different temperatures. And others are similar with respect to an environment consisting of certain drugs, yeah, where they behave similar. But two genes will not be similar across all the different conditions that are tested in a large experiment. I want to briefly mention that subspace clustering is part of a more general type of topics that's called multiple clustering solutions. We already discussed last week alternative clusters, which means that we take a global clustering method or several global clustering methods, change their parameters with the goal to find different valid clusters, yeah? To make the analyst aware of different possible interpretations of the data. Today we discuss subspace search and subspace clustering as two further topics in this area of multiple clustering solutions for high-dimensional data. I have mentioned this term already, but it needs to be explicit at this point once more, the so-called curse of dimensionality. Yeah? In German, the curse is der Fluch. Yeah? So if we have a low-dimensional space, then there are data that are dense, tight, close to each other, and therefore clustering in many cases really makes sense. If we have high dimensional data, typically all elements are quite far from each other. The distances grow exponentially with the number of dimensions. Yeah? And therefore at some point global clustering is no longer useful, does not lead to meaningful results. There is one more aspect to mention. Many large collections of data contain dimensions that are for a particular purpose not relevant, or dimensions that are very strongly correlated. So if you want to characterize patients, for example, and you want to understand whether weight is a risk factor for certain diseases or not. Maybe it's even a protective factor against some diseases. Then often the weight is collected, the size of the person is collected, the body mass index that relates the two to each other is collected, and then in addition the waist circumference and the hip circumference is collected, and all these represent slightly different information about whether a person is obese or not. But of course this information is only slightly different, which means it's also highly correlated. Yeah, so it may be useful to reduce the dimensions for a particular application before clustering is applied. Subspace search is about finding low dimensional subspaces of a high dimensional data set where clustering can be applied, where this is useful. I like the term a lot that is used in this context, that is a clusterable subspace. Yeah, a subspace where clustering probably leads to interesting results. So if we think about high dimensional data, then it becomes immediately obvious that there are many, many potential subspaces. In most algorithms, the search is restricted to axis-aligned subspaces. But it's important to note that this is already a strong restriction. An interesting subspace may be also oblique to the dimensions of the data set. That means it is not axis-aligned. But even if we restrict it to axis-aligned subspaces, then we really have a large number of possibly interesting subspaces. Yeah, they grow exponentially. You see this here, 2 and then n is the exponent in this equation. So just to give some examples, if we have 20 dimensions, which is not a lot, yeah, then we have a little bit more than 1 million axis-aligned subspaces. If n equals 30, we have more than a billion possible subspaces. Yeah, so we should not spend too much effort with every possible subspace if we have to analyze a billion of them. We need heuristics to prune this search. That means to find out quite fast that there are subspaces that are not interesting, where we should not look whether clustering is possible. So that is again the image I have shown in the beginning. Here's also the source for this image. A three-dimensional visualization of three-dimensional data and two-dimensional projections of the same data. Yeah. So while in this subspace consisting of the dimensions B and C, magenta colored dots represent a cluster and the turquoise colored dot represent a cluster, they do not represent a cluster in the A and B dimension. Yeah, they are completely intertwined. The same is true with red and green. Yeah, so we have clear two-dimensional subspace clusters in the AB space and in the BC space. In AC, indeed, we find the same clusters that we have seen here as well. Yeah, so that shows a little bit possible relations. Another example, yeah, these are the individual records, the individual data sets in our database, and these are the different dimensions, the different attributes, one may also say. Imagine these are all real valued information, and it is mapped to color. So the same color means that we have the same value. I used colors here, or the authors used colors here, because with colors we see much easier what belongs together, what is similar and what is not so similar. And we easily recognize that there is a cluster that relates to the dimensions 1, 2 and 3 here, and there is another cluster that relates to the dimensions 4, 5 and 6. Here's one data set, namely data set number 3, that is an element of this subspace cluster as well as of this subspace cluster. Yeah, that may easily happen. Yeah. So that's, by the way, a very nice paper from Michael Hund and colleagues. We also see that there are no two data sets that are similar in all dimensions. So if we would force this with a k-means type of clustering to say two or three clusters, these clusters would not be meaningful. Yeah, so I have to discuss terminology again, as we did already in some of the earlier lectures. Here we have two terms that are used synonymously: subspace clustering and projection clustering. Interestingly, even the authors that introduced these have very similar names, Agrawal and Agrawal. So the frequent term today is subspace clustering. Yeah, if you read something about projection clustering, that is the same. But I would use in the following the term subspace clustering only, because that is used meanwhile much more frequently. The formal description of the problem is here. If we have a set of objects in a database that has d dimensions, then a cluster in a subspace projection, C, is a number of objects and a number of dimensions, where this O is a subset of the database. It means it contains a subset of all the elements of the data sets, and the S is a subset from all dimensions that are available. And the clustering result contains the individual elements C1 to CK, where each element is an object in a certain subspace. So that's the formal definition. So there are two tasks, as already mentioned. We have to search for clusterable subspaces. And for this we need, again, I've used this term already several times, an interestingness measure. Yeah, how interesting is this subspace? And at the end, I rank the subspaces and perform the clustering perhaps in the top 10 subspaces, yeah, in the most interesting subspaces. Maybe n should not be 10, maybe it's a larger number, maybe it is not even specific numbers, a top n. It could be also that I cluster just all subspaces where our interesting measure is above a certain threshold. Yeah, that is the actual clustering process then. So what are the tasks in the visual analysis of subspace cluster? There is a nice paper that I used several times from Andrada Tatu from Konstanz University. So on the one hand, we have to display the subspaces, which means the involved dimensions. We have to show the similarity between the subspaces with respect to the dimensions involved and the topology. We have to display the clustering results in these subspaces and show relations between subspace clusters, relations in the sense that there are overlapping objects and overlapping dimensions, potentially at least. Subspace clusters may, of course, also be completely disjunct, but that is not necessarily the case. A related term in data mining is feature selection. Yeah? Feature selection is not what we want to discuss here. It is not the same. It is, in fact, different. Feature selection means that I have an information theoretic measure like entropy or information gain. And that tells me how useful it is to add another feature or another dimension. You see, again, feature is the term from data mining. Dimension is the term in other areas, to add another dimension or not. Yeah? But as useful as feature selection is, it is a global technique. Yeah? From my 100 dimensions that I have, feature selection may help me to find 20 dimensions where the redundancy is very low and where the entropy is quite high. And maybe further analysis should be restricted to these 20 dimensions. That could be a pre-processing step before subspace clustering, yeah? But it does not replace it. Yeah, subspace search algorithms return subspaces where clustering is useful, whereas subspace clustering actually performs the clustering. That can be integrated or it can be decoupled, yeah? In another paper from Andrada Tatu, these two completely different strategies to subspace clustering are discussed. And She argues that decoupling subspace search from the clustering is actually recommended because it is more flexible. It's a modular concept. It is also less biased. Yeah, subspace search is often biased to find, for example, particularly low-dimensional subspaces. Yeah, and it is also more effective, since uninteresting subspaces are no longer considered in the second stage where the actual clustering is performed. Yeah, so therefore, that is really the recommended strategy: first to search for interesting subspaces, and then to perform the clustering within them. Yeah, some assumptions and heuristics. We have already said that the number of subspaces is very large, and without any restrictions, it is even infinitively large. Yeah, axis-aligned subspaces is a subset, and that is often a useful restriction. Some algorithms expect a certain number of clusters. That is familiar to you from k-means or k-prototypes that we discussed last week, and then the search is optimized and adapted to this. Some algorithms are biased towards low-dimensional subspaces and consequently low-dimensional subspace clusters. In many applications, this is also useful. Yeah? The low-dimensional subspaces are often more interesting. High-dimensional subspaces may indicate a situation of overfitting a model to a problem. Yeah? But not always this is the case, so that we lose higher-dimensional subspace clusters in some cases may be a problem. Yeah, what is the pre-processing for subspace clustering? If we have incomplete data set, that's really a problem for these algorithms. Maybe they should be removed. That's not always possible. It could happen that we have high dimensional data, but for every dimension, some values are missing. And in total, 80% of the data sets have at least one missing dimension. If I should remove all of them, then I lose too much of my information. So maybe missing data can be interpolated or imputed. There are quite, advanced strategies to do this. Imputation is typically much more complex than saying, well, I don't have a value, I just take the average or the median. Yeah, there could be relations between the different dimensions, and if I know the other variables, perhaps I can make a guess, an informative guess about the missing value. So imagine I don't have the blood pressure for a person, but I know that the person has a heart disease and is 80 years old, then probably her blood pressure is higher than the average blood pressure of the population. Yeah. So this is what can happen when missing data is imputed. That is, of course, involving uncertainty. Yeah. To have data, measure data, is always better than to impute it. But to impute it may be better than to remove the data at all because something is missing. So categorical data are again a special situation. Yeah, also for subspace clustering, it's easier if we assume that everything are real valued. So categorical variables may be mapped to numerical values. Imagine we have a categorical variable with 6 values, and we map the values to 0, 0.2 until 1.2. Yeah. If, at least if there is an order, yeah, within these variables, that would be useful. For binary variables, we would map them just to 0 or 1. For numerical variables, we have the situation that we also discussed for global clustering, that the ranges of the dimensions may be very different, and therefore we should translate the range of the data from minimum maximum to 0, 1. Yeah, so that all the dimensions have the same minimum value and the same maximum value. And with this, typically also the variance, the standard deviation, is quite similar. Yeah, so that is the formula. It's quite simple how to derive the normalized value when you want to translate the range from min-max to 0, 1. Yeah, I want to go a little bit in detail with specific approaches, like with global clustering, I only explain very selected approaches, and even these approaches I do not explain in all details that are important for an efficient implementation, but basically I want to give you the overall idea, the sketch of an algorithm. Yeah? Ranking interesting subspaces from Keiling, from the group from Hans-Peter Kriegel in Unique, is a quite important algorithm. You may remember some observations that we have from density-based clustering. Yeah, so to some extent that is similar to the dbScan algorithm. Yeah, and in particular it is equal with respect to the parameters of an algorithm. dbScan has one parameter, min points, that is the minimal number of points a cluster should have. Yeah, and that has the same meaning here as well. And epsilon is the parameter that tells you whether or not two points are considered as belonging to a path and belonging to a cluster. Yeah, that's so to say the minimum distance required for objects to be considered as part of a cluster. So a dense region is then a set of objects connected to the core objects, and if we ask whether a subspace is interesting or not, then it depends primarily on the number of such dense regions and the amount of elements in them. If I have a subspace where with our parameters, epsilon and min points, nothing is really a cluster, then this subspace is not interesting. Yeah. So we count the number of objects in regions around core objects and divide this by the overall volume of this subspace. This gives us directly the interestingness measure, and back to the name of this algorithm, ranking interesting subspaces, that allows us to rank the subspaces according to this interestingness measure. So relevance, subspace is deleted if it is embedded in another subspace with higher interestingness. Yeah? Of course, I can have two-dimensional subspace that is quite interesting, but if I add one more dimension and the interestingness value is higher when adding this dimension, then probably the two-dimensional subspace is no longer very interesting. Yeah? Low-dimensional subspaces are embedded in higher-dimensional subspaces, and it is typically sufficient then to look at the higher dimensional subspace if the interestingness indeed increased. In many cases it will not increase, yeah? But if it increases, then the higher dimensional subspace is more interesting. Yeah, if we have parameters, we always should think about how we can guide the user in choosing the parameters appropriately. Yeah, we should not expect our users to be familiar with the details and the specific properties of an algorithm to make good choices. Yeah, so we should have good default values as a starting point for the analysis. And the authors of these algorithms thought about this and suggest the following. The midpoint parameter should be chosen such that it corresponds to the natural logarithm of the number of objects of the whole database. Yeah. So the natural logarithm. So here's my question for you. What is the natural logarithm of 1,000 objects or of 10,000 objects? Yeah. The natural logarithm is computed based on the Euler number, which is 2.01 something. So the question is which exponent I need to get 1,000 or 10,000. Yeah. The answer would be for 1,000, it is roughly 7, so it would be rounded to 7. Yeah, we would want to see clusters with at least 7 elements, otherwise we don't consider this as interesting. And with 10,000 objects, it would be approximately 9, would be rounded to 9. Yeah, and you can go further, with 1 million objects, it would be approximately 13. Yeah, just to give you a feeling for this idea. The choice of epsilon is more difficult. Yeah, that's the second parameter which is also needed. An upper bound for epsilon is found when we assume or compare our distribution to a completely uniform distribution, where all points in this particular subspace have the same distance to each other. If epsilon is chosen such that all points in a uniform contribution are considered a core object, that makes no sense, yeah? Because then we just consider basically everything as clusterable, yeah? So epsilon should be at least smaller than this. And the suggestion from Keiling is it should be this limit divided by 4. Yeah. So how we can interpret this? Basically like this. If we have a local density that is at least 4 times as high as the average density in this subspace, then this is a cluster. And if you remember some of the examples that we have looked at last week, then you see immediately this choice can be problematic. Yeah, it could be well that there are only regions that have 3 times the average density, or only 2 times the average density. Yeah, so maybe it is necessary to increase this epsilon value, and in some cases even this value may be too high and should be further decreased. So that is something where the user probably needs to play a little bit around. Surfing is another important algorithm. Surfing stands for subspaces relevant for clustering. It searches for subspaces without clustering them, like ranking interesting subspaces. And it does so by looking at the histogram of the k nearest neighbors, the distances to the k nearest neighbors. Yeah? Subspaces with non-uniform distributions are more interesting, is the idea here. So the problem with this algorithm, if you just naively implement this idea, is a performance problem. Yeah? Imagine you have 1 million data sets, you have 20 dimensions, so you also have 1 million of possible subspaces. And for this 1 million times 1 million possibilities, you have to look for, let's say, the 5 nearest neighbors. You have to compute the distance to the 5 nearest neighbors. That takes a lot of time. Even if you have a careful hierarchical data structure that somehow accelerates this distance computation, that just takes too long. But typically, it's not necessary to do this for really all elements. Yeah, it's like with an election. You first ask, let's say, 10,000 of representative people, what have you voted for? And then you can predict the election result. And you can do this with some uncertainty, but the uncertainty is quite low. And the same principle is applied here. So either you restrict the computation to a certain absolute number of elements, let's say 1,000, or to a certain percentage of the overall number of elements. Yeah, the surfing algorithm is a bottom-up algorithm, and that tells you that there are also top-down based approaches, of course. Bottom-up means we start with one dimension and try to add a second dimension and analyze whether the interestingness increases. And as long as this is the case, we would add further dimensions until adding further dimension does not help anymore. Then we have found a particularly interesting subspace. So what can be said about the properties of this algorithm and the results of this algorithm? It does not assume a specific clustering structure, a convex structure, for example, like k-means. Yeah, that is a good property. It is applicable for a wide range of numbers of dimensions. Yeah, this can find very small subspaces, medium-sized subspaces, larger subspaces. The question is, of course, how to choose k. Yeah, how many nearest neighbors we should take into account. We should not look only for the nearest neighbor, which would mean k equals 1. Even k equals 3 is probably too low. For values between 5 and 20, the algorithm is quite stable, meaning the results do not differ much. And then, of course, the lower number is the better one with respect to performance. Yeah? So to search for the 5 nearest neighbors and to compare them, that tells you enough about the local density for ranking the different subspaces here. So the resulting high-ranked subspaces tend to be similar, yeah, which is not a nice property because we are often more interested in a representative set of clustering results, as we have also discussed last week. So in addition to interestingness as a quality measure, often diversity is also interesting. And this algorithm would not ensure a high diversity of the results. So we talked about k nearest neighbors and their histograms, and I think that deserves an image to be explained. Yeah. So here are data with different local density. You see here the density is very low, here it's a bit higher. Here is it really high, so maybe this could be clusterable, and here as well. Yeah. So and this is a histogram that shows you the overall distance to the three nearest neighbors. So they are just added to the nearest neighbor, the second nearest, and the third nearest neighbor. And you see that for some points, this point for example, I would suppose, this distance is really high. Whereas for many other points, being part of a cluster, this distance is quite low. Yeah, that would be the mean value here. Yeah, not the median, but the mean value. Yeah. So that tells you if we are, let's say, at this point here, half of the mean value, so probably all the objects where this is the case should be considered as part of a cluster. Yeah. If we really would have a uniform distribution of the data, where basically all the points are at one of these grid cells, then this histogram looks like this. Yeah. All distances are the same as the mean distance. The variance is zero. So that definitely is not a clusterable subspace. Yeah, that is, of course, an extreme situation that you will not find with any real data that you collect somehow. But it tells you how different the situations can be. Yeah, interestingness. The difference of the k nearest neighbor distance to the mean value is computed here, and that tells you about the interestingness. Yeah, we count how many points are below this mean value. And the quality is finally defined as the normalized differences. Yeah, so here we first compute the difference between the mean value and our current point, the nearest neighbors. Here we determine how many objects fulfill this criterion that this difference is below a certain threshold, and the quality measure at the end is computed, yeah, either as zero if no point fulfills this criterion of having nearest neighbors that are far below the median value. Otherwise, it is yeah, the equation that has the difference and the below set, the cardinality of this set, taken into account. Yeah, that is the final quality measure used for ranking the subspaces. So it returns relevant subspaces ranked by this particular interestingness measure, but it performs no clustering. It just gives a hint where clustering is useful. And then it can be combined with any global clustering techniques. The authors here suggest to combine it with optics, the algorithm we briefly discussed last week. Yeah, maybe why not k-means would be a question for you to think about, and the answer of course depends on the properties of k-means. Yeah. So what are methods for the actual subspace clustering? So far we talked about finding interesting subspaces, now about the clustering. Most methods are bottom-up, start with individual dimensions and merge with others. And the monoticity assumption is important here. So if a subspace S contains a cluster that we call C, then all subspaces of S, that means all spaces with fewer dimensions, also contain this cluster. Yeah. If T, the subspace, does not contain a cluster, then also no superspace of T contains a cluster. So if I could not find a cluster in a two-dimensional subspace, then adding further dimension will not lead to a subspace. Yeah? And that is so important to prune the search for subspaces and to cluster in them. Yeah, clusters are merged if they have many points in common and the same dimensions. Yeah? Bottom-up approaches are more efficient here than top-down approaches, so therefore they are much more frequently used, in particular if the number of dimensions is higher, and I would say here higher when we have more than, let's say, 20 dimensions. Yeah, some more thoughts on how to prune the search and thus to make sure that these algorithms are applied in an efficient manner. We should prefer subspaces with high variance. If in one particular subspace the variance of the data is very low, which means more or less all data sets have for this dimension the same value, then this should not be part of an interesting subspace. Yeah? For generating a set of subspaces, we should avoid high redundancy. And that is again the relation to what we briefly discussed about feature selection. Feature selection would tell us that adding a further dimension does not lead to too much additional information, and therefore in the pre-process of subspace clustering we can use feature selection to avoid dimensions that only indicate redundancy. Yeah, instead of exploring similar spaces, they may also be grouped, and we can look at one representative of them. So that's an interesting and maybe somehow strange idea. First we compute clusters, and then we compute clusters of clusters, namely clusters that are very similar are grouped together. And the analyst then should not look at all these clusters, but only at a few representatives. Yeah, that can be useful if the search for interesting subspaces yields thousands of results. And thousands of results indeed may occur if we have millions of possible subspaces. Yeah, further not similar subspaces should also be displayed in order to make the analyst aware of all the interesting structures in the data. Yeah, what does it mean that we have redundancy with respect to the dimensions? Basically, that is the fractions of dimensions that are contained in both subspaces. Yeah. So if we have here a three-dimensional subspace and here another three-dimensional subspace, and they have two dimensions in common, this means that the Tanimoto coefficient is 66.66%. Yeah, quite simple. Yeah, there are different paradigms and algorithms for subspace clustering. Cell-based algorithms search for grid cells where the number of objects is above a certain threshold. These are the, I would say, the easiest algorithms, quite easy to program, but they have some obvious problems, which I will show in a minute. There are, again, density-based algorithms that search for subspaces where the local density is increased, like dbScan and optics for global clustering. And there are clustering-based algorithms, which means that they are steered by parameters of global clustering, like parameters related to the expected results, e.g. the number of clusters or the average number of dimensions in a cluster. These are referred to as clustering-based. That is based on a survey article from Müller and al., this classification. Yeah? So let's describe first a cell-based method, an early one and frequently used one is CLIC, clustering in Quest. That's the abbreviation for this, and that pioneered cell-based methods. It generates clusters of arbitrary shapes, which is good. Yeah, it's a bottom-up method that seeks dense rectangular cells in all data subspaces with a high density. And what does it mean to have a high density? again depends on certain parameters that need to be carefully chosen. Cell-based algorithms have their name because a grid is used, a constant regular grid overlaid on the data. Yeah, regular grid means the grid cells have the same distance in all dimensions. So the results heavily depend on the resolution of this grid. Yeah, by the way, that's not only true for subspace clustering. Whenever algorithms are based on a grid, counting on a grid, then the results depend heavily on the grid resolution. Yeah, that's referred to here to this epsilon parameter. And the minimum number of points per cell, the min points parameter that we know from DBSCAN. Clusters represent connected components in a graph where the nodes represent the dense units. So we will see that this constant size of the grid may lead to problems. I should show an image, I will do so in a minute. That lead to the idea of refining this algorithm by freely positioning the cells or even adjusting the size of the cells to make this more flexible. But then, of course, it's also a much more complex algorithm, yeah, adaptive grid size. So here we see a grid overlaid to a two-dimensional space. We have our points here. And the question is, which clusters do we have here, or which clusters do we expect? Probably, if I would ask you, you would say, here's a cluster. Yeah, these points belong to a cluster, and all the other points do not belong to a cluster. So imagine that we choose the parameter min points equals 5. You see our overlaid grid. So we iterate over all our cells, two for loops, and look whether there is a cell where we have at least 5 points. And it turns out not a single cell fulfills this criterion, no cluster. Yeah, here we have 4, again 4, 4, 4. By the way, here we have also 4. Yeah, so that does not work. So then we can say, well, we look for min points equals 4. When min points equals 4, it turns out this belongs to a cluster, and this, and this, and this. And since these cells are adjacent to each other, it is summarized, here is a cluster, which is good. Yeah, we want to see this cluster. But we see another cluster here, where also this criterion is fulfilled. Although the density between these points is much larger. Yeah, so that would be the result with 4. So there is nothing in between 4 and 5. Yeah, that tells you, for no min point parameter selection, we get the desired result that we have one cluster in this subspace, namely here. Yeah? And that is, of course, based on the grid size. Yeah? If we would also adapt the grid size, then there would be a combination of min point and epsilon parameters with the right result. Yeah? But that's a quite tedious approach. So other algorithms, even with the hypercubes that can be freely positioned, have in principle similar problems. Not so often. In some cases they can get a better solution, but the problem in general is not completely avoided. Yeah? That means, on the one hand, we may have clusters where objects are considered to belong to a cluster that actually do not, and also that we have wrong objects connected to a cluster. Yeah? So here, for example, we have a cluster that goes like this, and here we have in one cell a cluster, and then we have points that are in the same cell, but since the resolution here is not so high, they are farther away from these points than the distance between all these points, so these actually should not belong to a cluster. Yeah? But with a cell-based algorithm, they would be considered as belonging to the cluster. Yeah? Whereas here the problem would be, that would be correctly considered with a reasonable min point selection as being part of a cluster, but probably in the adjacent cells not enough points are, so they are not considered as part of the same cluster, so the cluster is cut here at the grid border. Yeah, subclue is a density-based method from Keiling again. So a bit later, and that yeah is better with respect to the properties of the resulting clusters. The clusters have arbitrary size and shape, which is good. A threshold, of course, is necessary here as well. In this case, it's a density threshold, so the result is depending on this, but the quality is better. As often in computer science, an algorithm that leads to a better quality, to better results, needs more time for this. Yeah, there are quick and dirty solutions that are fast and the quality is not so good. Subclue is a solution that is better, but it also takes more time. And in particular, if the number of dimensions is beyond 15, the performance is considerably reduced. Yeah. So with this global threshold T, we have, of course, the problem that we will only find subclusters with a certain density. Yeah. If there are regions in the data where the density is very low, and then there are some parts of this region where the density is increased, but still below the overall average, this could not be detected as a cluster. Subclue has a certain bias towards low dimensionality. Yeah, it is very unlikely that high-dimensional subclases result. Procluse is another frequently used method that I briefly want to mention, a clustering-based approach with two parameters, namely the number of clusters that is expected, that reminds you to k-means, and the average dimensionality. There is a random initialization that also reminds you to k-means, and then there is a refinement stage where the meadow-eats are changed and adapted for well-fitting subspaces. Yeah, and a quality criterion is applied, and the algorithm is iterated as long as the result gets not much better anymore. This is an algorithm that prefers large clusters. It is efficient, it's quite simple, and a nice property is that it is quite robust against noise. Yeah, so what are parameters of subspace clustering? Now that we have dealt a bit with several algorithms, it's the average or maximum number of dimensions, it's the expected number of clusters, and also a so-called cluster dominance factor is often used. That means how much the density within a cluster should exceed the average density. Yeah, two would mean the density is at least twice as high than in the global average. Yeah, such a cluster dominance factor is primarily used for grid-based approaches. Let me make a few remarks on categorical data. The term subspace clustering is unusual if categorical data should be analyzed. Instead, what is done for categorical data is to search for frequent items, yeah? For example, products bought by several customers, yeah? Similarity with respect to this property. Frequent item mining, that's the term in data mining for these kinds of algorithms. Very few algorithms deal with hybrid data that involves the continuous numerical data and categorical data. One of them is the HSM method by Müller that considers the expected density in subspaces, yeah, with the cluster dominance factor. We are a certain factor above the average density, and for the categorical subspaces, it is the expected frequency, yeah. If I have, for example, males and females, then the expected frequency would be that I have 50% males and 50% females. If I have a certain subspace where I have more than 70% males, for example, then this means perhaps these are products primarily bought by men. Yeah? So that makes something interesting if the expected frequency is different from the global average. Yeah. So we need again a special normalization for the categorical and the continuous numerical data to treat them properly and weight them properly. The categorical data is easier to analyze here, or faster to analyze, because here we just compute and count frequency. Yeah? And counting frequencies is faster than density estimation. Yeah? You remember density estimation means that I have to understand what are the nearest neighbors, how far they are away, and so on. So that takes more time. Yeah? So if I have 20-dimensional data and 10 dimensions are categorical, compared to a situation where I have 20-dimensional data and none of them is categorical, the subspace clustering will be faster with the 10 categorical dimensions. So this brings me to the visualization. Yeah? So far we discussed subspace clustering. Now the question is how to visualize and interactively explore the results. Of course, typically as part of an iterative process where we can start the clustering again if we have the impression that with other parameters we get better results. So before thinking about the visualization, we need to think about the information that should be visualized. What should be conveyed? The overlapping dimensions of the subspaces, that's important. Also the overlapping subspaces in terms of which elements they have in common. And finally, the individual memberships of objects to subspaces. Yeah. So, and to continue this, there are properties of individual clusters, how many objects, which dimensions belong to a cluster and which dimensions do not contribute to the cluster. That may also be useful information. And what are the distributions in these dimensions? Yeah, we have discussed in the very first lecture about the rank by feature framework that analysts often are interested first in understanding the dimensions in the data and how the data is distributed within them. Here the same is true for the results of subspace clustering. So we look at individual clusters, but we also want to compare clusters. Yeah? How different they are, for example, with respect to objects involved, dimensions involved, how different they are in size, for example. So that is cluster comparison. And then cluster quality is important. Yeah, what can we say about the quality of a cluster in terms of some quality metrics? And how sensitive is the result to slight changes of the parameter? Yeah, I mentioned this name already several times. Andrada Tattoo in her PhD thesis made a number of nice contributions to this topic of subspace clustering and the visualization of subspace clustering results. Yeah. So at the end, we have a parameter space and the user needs some support to navigate this parameter space, which more or less means to find good parameter combinations without just trying everything. Yeah. Navigation here means that the user gets some guidance. So why visualization is so important here, even more important than for global clustering? For global clustering, we have established automatic quality assessments, although we have not discussed them in the lecture that will follow. But for overlapping subspace clusters, these values are not very meaningful, and there are no other really primarily quality indicators for subspace clusters. So visualization here really serves the process of understanding the quality of the subspaces. With subspace clustering, we have even more data and more perspectives on the data compared to global clustering. Yeah, we have the more complex information here to convey. Yeah, so this brings me to the fact of visualizing subspace clustering and assessing this. My thoughts here are derived from a paper from Michael Hund. That is a name I already mentioned several times because he also came up with a number of good contributions. So I would be interested in understanding how many overlapping dimensions and instances or objects I have. Also about coverage. Yeah. So ideally, I would wish that most instances of my database belong at least to one cluster. Yeah. Because otherwise, if subspace clustering should serve my further analysis, I would not consider these instances at all. Yeah. Are most dimensions part of any cluster? Is also interesting. If one dimension does not contribute to any cluster at all, well, we should probably forget it. Yeah, maybe it's not interesting at all for the further analysis. The cluster characteristics are important, so what numbers of dimensions the clusters have, and cluster quality metrics such as their compactness, that describes individual clusters, or separability, that describes a set of clusters. So what I said in the beginning, the major information visualization techniques are also useful here for showing the results of subspace clustering, namely scatterplot visualizations, which we have seen several times, parallel coordinates, which we will see a lot, heat maps and linked views. So here's an example of a parallel coordinate view to show subspace clustering results. We have the dimensions starting from 0 to 8, and we have a subspace cluster that is composed of dimension 1, 4, and 6, but dimension 0, 2, 3, 5, 7, and 8 do not contribute to this cluster. That is indicated by the color. Yeah? The red color indicates this contributes to clustering. Here we see the objects, the instances. Yeah? So one polygon here, starting in the dimension 0 and going all the way to dimension 8, corresponds to one data set. What we see here is that the data is quite diverse in dimension 8, whereas it is quite coherent in dimension 7. Yeah? So the range of values here is quite small. This relates to the elements of one particular subspace cluster. Yeah? So these red lines here do not show all data sets in our database, only those that belong to the subspace cluster here in this three red dimensions. And to visually assess the plausibility of this subspace clustering, we look particular at dimension 1, 4, and 6. What can we expect here? We can expect that the values are similar in these dimensions, 1, 4, and 6. They should be more similar in these dimensions than in other dimensions, like 3, for example. Because if they would be also so similar in dimension 3, well, then we should add dimension 3 to our interesting subspace. Yeah? So what do these other colors here tell us? That is a color coding of the frequency of values. Dark means these values occur often. So for dimension 2, for example, many instances have a value that is here in this very low range. Here is another region with high frequency. And this region with high frequency we see also within our subspace cluster. Whereas objects that have this value that occurs frequently, which the dark color indicates, are not at all part of our subspace cluster. Yeah? Even if dimension 2 does not belong to our subspace. Yeah? So that is the whole amount of information that we see in this parallel coordinate plot combined with frequency counting and color coding for the individual dimensions, so that you also see how the elements of this subspace cluster are distributed compared to the overall distribution of the data. Yeah, scatterplot-based representations are very useful if we have two dimensions. Often we have more than two dimensions, so then we get problems. Then the results need to be projected to 2D or to 3D, but yeah, honestly, 2D visualizations are mostly better to show results. Yeah? So typically results then are projected to 2D. So this is possible, of course. I can project data from any high-dimensional space to 2D, but of course I lose information. Yeah? And the question is how much information I lose and can I minimize this loss of information? What is actually the information that I want to perceive? That leads to a topic that we want to discuss later in more detail, namely dimension reduction. Dimension reduction algorithms try to preserve the distances in high-dimensional space when projecting it to a low-dimensional space. Yeah? So if I have a pair of points that is very close to each other in high-dimensional space, no matter how the layout of the low-dimensional space is, but the distance should be small as well. At least it should be smaller then the distance of a pair of points that was large in high-dimensional space, that should not have the same small distance in the low-dimensional space. Yeah? because otherwise I'm misled if I want to assess in the projection things like outliers and clusters and regression. Yeah, we talk about this later. To mention at least one name here, because it is used often in connection with subspace clustering visualization, multidimensional scaling is one of the frequently used dimension reduction techniques, a quite flexible nonlinear technique with many useful properties, which is the reason why it is used here. Yeah, and indeed we see already one example here that is from the VISA approach, Visual Subspace Cluster Analysis, from Ira Assant and her colleagues. And all these circles here indicate subspaces. And the subspaces are color-coded, and you see the legend for this here. If a subspace cluster involves more dimensions, then it is red, and if it contains few dimensions, it is yellow. We do not know exactly from this legend what less and more means. Maybe less is something like two, and red is something like five or six. Yeah, so we see immediately clusters, partially overlapping clusters, we see their dimension distribution and also their size. Yeah, the size of the circle indicates the size of the subspace cluster in terms of the number of objects that belong to the subspace cluster. So this raises one question that's interesting to you. Maybe you think a little bit about it. The question is, how do I map the size of a cluster to a circle? There are at least two obvious options. One would be to map it to the diameter of the circle. Yeah. So if I have a cluster with 10 elements and another with 20 elements, then the diameter of the circle with the 20 elements is twice as large. That means that the square is four times as large. Yeah, you know the square of a circle is the squared, is proportional to the squared diameter. You could also map the size of the circle to the area. Yeah, so then the diameter does not grow as strongly. Yeah, if I say the area of the circle should be twice as much if I have twice as many members, then I have a different mapping. Yeah, so the question is, which of these variants is better? And there were experiments, perceptual experiments, where users are asked to infer information from such visualization, and it turns out it should be something in between. Yeah, if you map the size to the diameter, then people overestimate the differences in the size, whereas if you map it to the area, they slightly underestimate it. Yeah, so a very good solution with respect to human visual perception would be something that is below these two. That is something that tells you a bit how careful you often need to be with how to visualize data. Another aspect I want to make you aware of, if you think about this image here, is many circuits here are shown. Some of them are completely enclosed by others. So the question is, in which sequence I draw these circles. If I would draw this large yellow circle first, and then later this small one, and this small one, and this one, they would not be visible. They would be behind the already drawn large circle. Yeah, so here an algorithm was used that orders the circles by their size, and first smaller circles are drawn, which gives them a higher chance of being visible in front of a larger enclosing circle where they are fully embedded. There is no guarantee that we see all circles. Yeah, still there may be some small circles behind here, but with this strategy, this probability is at least reduced. So, and then that is, of course, only an overview. The user may be interested in details. And the first level of detail would be, I want to understand one particular subspace. So the user has selected a subspace, which you see here. And it turns out that this subspace is composed by this dimension, this, and these three further dimensions. So red indeed means obviously five. Yeah, these five dimensions, whereas the other dimensions do not contribute to this subspace cluster. About the distribution of the data, we see only very summarized information, namely a box plot, yeah, which may tell either the average value plus minus the standard deviation, or in terms of a box plot, the interquartile range. Yeah. So we discussed this question already. Yeah, spatial proximity reflects the similarity between the clusters. Yeah, so this cluster is much more different from this one than it is from this one. So, and then details are shown for the selected cluster on demand, of course. So, and the question is how many of these clusters I should really generate and analyze. And Ira Assant, yeah, suggests a technique that's actually quite simple, but very effective, and therefore I really think it can be recommended. That's called bracketing, yeah, an approach to parameter selection. We carry out the algorithm with different parameters. We sample a certain interval from very low to very high values, maybe with three or five in-between values, and show to the user the results. And the user may select from them and say, well, that's the level I want to have, or this one. That is a technique, this bracketing, that comes originally from computational photography, where you also have, for some parameters, very different values. And for the user, it's probably not easy to select the right one in advance. And this bracketing is used to help the user to guide to the parameter space. Yeah. Yeah, of course, if we have many clusters, the likelihood of overlaps is strongly increased. Yeah, so probably we should not use this subspace cluster visualization as the base for our further investigation, because it just contains too many clusters, and some of them probably are not even visible. So, and then I want to also see the individual elements of one subspace cluster. Yeah. So first we looked at the composition of all the subspace clusters. Then we saw that we could select one subspace cluster and get some information summarizing this subspace cluster. What we see here is all the data sets within this subspace cluster and their values. Yeah. It's a type of matrix visualization. We have the dimensions of our data set and we have the data sets. Yeah. So within one column, we have all the data sets, and we see the values here for a selected data set. Here is one selected, and they are shown in bold for the dimensions that contribute to the subspace cluster, yeah, six dimensions in this case, and in gray for the other values that do not belong to this subspace. Yeah. So here is a 3D visualization, which was also developed for this purpose, so then we don't have circles, but instead spheres. By the way, there is a nice link, open subspace, with open source implementations of subspace cluster visualization techniques. Yeah, that is the overview again here with this bracketing leading to these different configurations. Yeah, I think that is a good point to make a break and finish this lecture. Thanks a lot for your attention.